thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yeah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad, I'm so glad, so glad. The blood will never lose its power. Never, never.
You. God bless you. Give somebody a high five and tell them today is your moment. Today is your hour. Today is your day to be totally set free. I don't know what's been holding you captive, but Jesus told me to tell you I paid it all. And whatever you can't make up, he said, I already made it up for you. He paid it all. We bless you, Father. We give you glory. We give you honor. Come on, let's give him praise. Let's lift your hands in his wonderful presence. Amen. Amen. Some of y'all. So, all right, Pastor. I'm tired now. I'm tired. But how many know God has been so good to us? I'm leaping in my spirit, Pastor Tyrell, because the devil tried to steal this. I love you. He tried to steal this, but how many know that no weapon formed against you shall be able to prosper? So we are excited. We are thankful for this amazing, awesome day. Amen. Look around you. Amen. This is why he died. This is why we had to keep believing. This is why we had to keep standing. This is why we had to keep dreaming. And I was sitting there, and I heard the Lord said, tell them they're about to see everything they prayed for. Y'all didn't hear that. He said, you're about to see everything you've been praying. Oh, you better receive that. Some things are taught, but other, everything you've been praying for, you're about to see it. I said, you're about to see it. Now give God a praise in advance. Put a praise on that. I'm about to see my... I might not preach after that one. You're about to see everything you prayed for. See, some folk got to see it to believe it, but Jesus says, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. You ought to be just praising him because you believe to see. David said, I would have fainted. I would have given up. I would have just let life go. But because I believe to see the goodness of the Lord. And there's somebody in here that's been standing on the word. There's somebody in here that's been holding on to a word. There's somebody in here that was about to give up, but God says, no, don't let go. Hold on to the promise, because you're about to see everything that you've been praying for. Can I just get about 100 believers that would say, Pastor, that's my word, because I've been trusting Jesus. And I'm here to tell you there's resurrection power all over this place to resurrect your dream. To resurrect your problem. Bring the answers to all of your issues. There's resurrection grace in this place today. You may be seated. You may be seated. I got a timer. I have a timer, so I'm not going to be real before you long, but I think this is an amazing day. And I would be remiss of me to try to go right into the few things I'm going to share with you this morning without giving the people who have put this excellent, magnificent, glorious, anointed presentation together. Will we show them all some love? I'm going to call some names quickly. I'm going to call some names. And as I call your name, can you just quickly come? Don't worry, I'm not going to be long. I'm not even going to be that long, y'all. Some names, Dr. Carla Bowens. Amen. Thank you. Come on, just come up. Minister Adrian Holland and Monique Lyre with the dance group. Come on, where are you quickly? Are they here? Pastor, our amazing youth pastor, Pastor Charles Anderson. Come on, y'all. And children's ministry coordinator. Y'all better give it up for him because these are your babies. I said, these are your babies. Pastor Karen Gatlin. Oh, there she is. Bless her heart. Come on. Amen. And I tell you, that sister that kicked it off with the narration, Michelle, my God, where's Michelle? Bless your heart, bless you. And everyone has done just amazing. And listen, there's so much that goes into providing this kind of atmosphere because we believe, now let me tell you something, Jesus is alive every Sunday in this church. This ain't no stage, my friend. This is ministry. That's why we just can't let anybody just get up here, because it's not a stage. Come on, amen? But this is ministry, and there's a lot that goes in this kind of presentation and to provide this kind of environment. Even from early this morning, our prayer intercessors were here early in the morning praying, interceding that the Spirit of the Lord would move and minister and transform and heal and set free so that when you leave out of here, you'll be able to dream again. Somebody shout hallelujah. You'll be able to dream again. Will you give these wonderful people, I don't know where the others are. I guess they're somewhere. They're changing. Okay, they're changing. But let's give them all a wonderful hand. Show them that we're. Come on, I see Adrian back there. God bless you. Come on. Thank you so much. Thank you for the work you all have put in. We appreciate it. We thank you so much for that. And we're training our youth. This ministry is with all the grace within us, minister to every generation. This is not just for the children, the youth, but it's for all ages. The vision of Dream Life is to teach our children how to dream big. Amen. Amen. Teach our children that through the Lord Jesus Christ, they can be anything God ordained them to be. They're not hindered by their race, their color, their environment, because God is God above all gods. They're made in the creation of God. To teach our youth how to discover their dreams and develop their dreams through the Lord Jesus Christ. And then to teach the adults who have lived life and have been through some trials and tribulations, have been through some disappointments in life, to teach you, that you, no matter where you are in your life, can dream again. Somebody shout hallelujah. Dream again. I've always introduced my lovely wife. Will you give your first lady a crown? Come on. Come on, y'all. You want to know what makes me tick? What keeps me going? What's I'm going to read in your hearing, and I'm going to be about 10 minutes in with this message. Because what's important to me and what's important every Sunday in this church is that you understand. The Bible says, in all you're getting, get what? An understanding. I'm looking at all of you that are dressed so nicely and so beautifully, and I think that's wonderful. One of the things the enemy is trying to do is bring casuality to Christianity. Now, I don't think, we don't always come, we don't always be suit down. We can come with jeans, you can dress any kind of way in this church. We're not caught on a dress code. But I think it's wonderful when we can just give God our best. I mean, I'm looking at our children, they look nice. I mean, if you're going to give anybody your best, it ought to be God. Amen. So I'm blessed by that. But if you go to Hebrews, the 10th chapter, I'm going to read and you hear me because I don't know when I'm going to get some of you back again. But I'm so glad you're here today. I'm so glad you're here. Every seat is filled just about in this place today. To God be all the glory. Hebrews 10:1. I want you to know what really took place on this amazing season and time in which we reflect on. I don't want you to just come to church and say, I felt good. We talked about the story of Jesus. I want what you experienced today to impact your life on a daily basis. I want what you experienced today and learned today to impact every area of your life. This year is a year of purpose. And God is strategically arranging things in our lives to bring us into the center of his purpose for our lives. We understand that life can be sweatless and life can be fun if you're in God's purpose. Doesn't mean you won't have any challenges, but some of y'all are living too hard. And God intended for you to live and to have a big life. And Jesus said, I came that you might have life. When I was in church, they told us, he just came that we might have heaven. And so we worked so hard just to get to heaven every day. And we just felt that God was just this neurotic parent waiting to slap our hand every time we did something wrong. And I didn't understand that when he came to give us life. And this life that he gives me is so powerful. It's called Zoe. It's eternal life. That watch, it's so powerful that even death itself cannot stop it. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, you ain't going to ever die. Tell me, you're not going to ever die. Now, you may not, watch this now, you have a destination, but you'll never die. You are you for the rest of you. All right? Hebrews 10:1 says, for the Lord is a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of those things. It could never be the same sacrifices which they offer continually year by year, perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, once purified, would no longer be conscious of sin? But in those sacrifices, there was an annual reminder of sins. For it was not possible that the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when he came into the world, he said, sacrifices and offerings you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. And burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, you have no pleasure. Then I said, see, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the volume of the book. This is Jesus speaking. Previously, when he said you did not desire sacrifices and offerings, you have had no pleasure in burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, which are offered in accordance with the Lord. Then he says, see, I have come to do your will, O God. He takes away the first, that's the first covenant, that he might establish the second, that's the new covenant. Verse 10, by this will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus once and for all. Everybody say once and for all. When I was coming up, we had to get saved every revival. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But the Bible says once and for how long? Okay, look at this. Watch this. But every priest stands daily ministering repetitively, offering the same sacrifices, which could never take away sins. Here it is. By this man, say this man. That's speaking of Jesus. After he offered one sacrifice, that's all it took. That's all it took. One sacrifice for sins forever. How long? He sat down at the right hand of God since the time he has been now waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool. Here it is, verse 14. For by one offering, say how many offerings? He has forever perfected those who are being sanctified. one offering, one sacrifice, and that's all it took. My subject quickly this morning is Jesus paid it all. You cannot add to what he's done. Now, we try to because of what we've been taught in religion, and because of our wrong believing, we're not experiencing the life God has for us. Now, I want you to strip off your religious mindset, strip off your religiosity, forget about your theology before you walked in here, and I want you to act as if you really want to hear from Father. Because your life is about to change in the next 5 to 7 minutes. Holy Spirit, thank you for ministering your word today. Jesus paid it all. I came up and I would hear this expression, Jesus died for my sins. Jesus came to save us from our sins. How many heard that before? Come on, with you. I really didn't know what that meant. What I did know, it meant that I did a whole lot of things wrong. Come on, wave your hand. You've done some things wrong. Keep looking straight ahead. Nobody knows I'm talking about you. I did a lot of things wrong, and I knew that what was bothering me, I needed to get free from. So for that reason, I accepted that, well, if Jesus forgave me, you know, then I'm forgiven. But I didn't really understand what that meant. But as I grew in the faith, I couldn't understand that except you understand that fundamental truth, everything you're trying to do in life was not going to work. It'll be a drudgery. It'll be a struggle. It'll be a challenge. You'll be in and out of church, in and out of religion, in and out of relationships. One minute you're saved, sometimes you feel like you're saved, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you feel like God, sometimes you don't. Everybody who's in this temple today has been ordained to be saved. There is no way in all of heaven, with all the hell that's going on outside there, with the darkness that's in the world, with the struggles that you've had in your life, with the things you've gone through in your life, and you end up at church on Sunday morning, you know God has a purpose for your life. So I kept trying to figure, what do you mean by Jesus died for your sins? He saved us from sins. Well, to understand that, you got to understand the nature of sin. Sin is described in Scripture as a debt. Anybody know anything about debts? Sin is described as a debt. In other words, when man sinned, he owed God. God gave him life, God gave him rebirth, but because he transgressed, he didn't do what God told him to do, he sinned. And sin is a debt, so now he owed God something. Now, when you owe somebody something, it translates into a weight, because debt is weight. Come on, I ain't got much longer, just follow me now. Debt is weight, saints. Sin is spiritual debt when you have on your conscience that you owe God. You will never be satisfied until you pay God. Anybody here ever owed anybody some money? Just keep looking straight ahead. Somebody say, yeah, I owe some folk right now, bless God. How many know that when you owe people money, it weighs on you? I mean, you walk in church, man, you see them coming, you got to go the other way because you could like, it weighs on you no matter what you do. I mean, you think about all the people you got to pay back, the calls, the harassment, I don't care what it is. There's something about debt that weighs because debt is really equivalent to a weight. Anybody ever hurt somebody or did somebody wrong and you needed forgiveness? You owe somebody an apology. Come on, raise your hand. Some of you owe some people an apology right now.
And every time you see them, you want to tell them you're sorry. You know there's some guys here, maybe they talk to a few men, and you made some mistakes in life, and you feel like you've damaged your children, and you damaged the marriage, and you, now you're on your second, maybe even on your third, and you're like, man, I done made a mess. I've hurt some people, and I've really disappointed some real treachery, like the old folks used to say, some trifling stuff. And so whether you realize or not, you are carrying that debt. You are carrying that weight. You may try to, you know, brush it off at the club and get your, you know, get your freak on. But when the freak is done, you got to live with that weight of what you did. Sin is a weight, and this is why so many people are not experiencing life, because they got these weights. And I was moving a whole lot faster till I picked these up. Don't be deceived by how small these are. These things are heavy. And so you're living your life like this. And some of you come to church like this. And I believe me, I can't move any faster than what I'm moving. You're weighted down in the spirit realm. You're weighted down in the financial realm. You're weighted down emotionally, so you can't move forward. You can see the goal, but it's taking you so long to get there. I know my life should be much further than what it is right now. But I got weights. I got weights. I got things I have not let go. I'm carrying stuff. I'm carrying, you know, the hardest part is not even to ask God to forgive you. The hardest part is to ask you to forgive you. And if you walk with these long enough, you get tired. Now you start lashing out at life. And now people are trying to figure out why you're just not happy, why you're so angry. But you ain't angry. You're tired. I can't pay these bills. It's just too much. This is my third job in 2 years. My children don't even want to talk to me any longer. Nobody believes in me. Nobody trusts me. I can't get my business started. Nobody wants to lend me any more money. I'm weighted. My home is not a haven. It's a war zone. When I go home, I better put on my boxing gloves because I'm tired. I came here for just a few moments to minister to those of you that are tired of carrying weights. And that's why Jesus says, when you come to me, oh, ye that labor. I know you got a job, but your life has now become a labor. And are heavy laden, and I who give you. Rest. That's what it meant. See, Hebrews is telling us that under the old covenant, the old system, our relationship was based solely on obedience to the law of Moses, the do's and the don'ts. But it says that that system could not free us, because when we stopped lying, we started cheating. And when we stopped cheating, we started adultery, affairs. And it says so the first system could never satisfy God. In fact, the only reason why he gave us the first system was to show you that you'll continue to carry those weights until you come to Jesus. Now here's what Hebrews says, and watch this. Hebrews says that under the new system, under the old system, not only did you have to obey God, but under the old system, you had to keep sacrificing animals. And one day, priest went in at the first time after he was done, you got reminded again what you were doing wrong. So he had to find another lamb. Then he had to come back again because you sinned again. You couldn't stop it. So he had, the more you sin, the heavier it got, and the more sacrifices were required. And do you know people still do that today? Some of y'all came here today just to get your religious conscience satisfied. If I can sacrifice today, then maybe Jesus will give me some points. I'm here to free you from that system. The Bible says that by one sacrifice, he forever perfected, which means that there is nothing you can do to lift the weight off you. I don't care how many religious acts, I don't care how many good things you do, as far as God's concerned, the weight will stay on you until you trust me that Jesus Christ has already paid the price. In other words, your believing is wrong. If you think that you're going to walk out of here and never do anything else wrong again, if you think you're going to leave here and never fail in life again, you are deceiving yourself, my friend. Everybody in here has blown it. Keep on blowing it, but we're trusting Jesus. So God says, you cannot do it. So I'm going to give one sacrifice to settle the sin issue for good. Yes, sir. So he gave Jesus, and Jesus gave himself as an offering. No more sacrifices, no more offerings. You prepared a body for me, so I'm going to give my body as a sacrifice. They can kick it, they can bruise it, they can take nails. He was beaten so bad, he was bruised so bad, he didn't even look like a human being. But I got to give it up for them because I don't want them to have this weight of sin in trying to live their lives. So he forever sanctified you. He perfected them forever, watch this, who are being sanctified. Which means God knows that even when you get right with God, I'm still going to have to work with you. Look at somebody and tell them, you ain't nothing but a work in process. With your sanctified, speaking in tongues, on fire for God's self, you still ain't nothing but a work in process. So the question is not whether or not you can come out of here and leave out of here and get that religious thing right. The question is very simple. Do you really believe that Jesus Christ has paid it all? Glory to God. He said to me early this week, son, until they believe that I paid it all, they'll never be free. Because life is going to cause you to feel sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. But if you believe that Jesus satisfied, he made you righteous, and you can receive that free gift of righteousness today, today, no matter what you've done, if you come to him, he can take the weights off you. And not only we take the spiritual weight, but if you keep continuing in his word, you'll know the truth, and the truth will set every other area of your life free. So some of you have been trying to be free and been trying to get free in life, even Christians. And the reason why you're not free is because you haven't settled that he paid it all. Whether you're up, whether you're down, it's still paid for. Whether you got money in your pocket or you don't, it's still paid for. Whether you're sick or you're well, it's still paid for. Whether your marriage has tension or not, it's still paid for. You all got weaknesses, but God says, "We do my grace is sufficient and it is paid for all." Now somebody give God a shout if you're going to receive your salvation and receive the free gift of righteousness and say, "Lord, thank you for lifting the weight off me." Come on, give him a praise. I'm done. What I want for the next few moments is some honest people in here that will say, "Pastor Ken, I really believe God. I know there's a God, but I can't get this religious thing together." God's not requiring that. He's requiring you first to believe that I paid it all. And if you can start believing right, you can start living right. If you can start believing right, you can live free from sin, death, and everything else the enemy tries to bring against you. You can say, "Devil, he's forever perfected me." Can I talk to people here today who say, "Pastor Ken, I've been carrying these weights. I can't get it together. I've tried marriage, I've tried money, I've tried sex, I've tried drugs, I tried church. Jesus wants to take the weights off today. Just receive what he's already done for you." That's where it starts. Not how good you are, not how much you've been right. No. Every head bow, every eye closed. If I'm talking to you and you say, "Preacher, that message was for me. I don't want church. I don't want religion. I just want Jesus, I want God. I want a peace that I don't have. I want a joy that I don't have." Can I tell you that when you start coming to him, he has power to restore everything back in your life? A few years ago, I did the unspeakable thing for a pastor. I went through a divorce 6 years ago, and I thought everything in my life was over. I'm not supposed to experience that. I'm a preacher's son. My family's been silent. How did I pick up that weight? How did I get that condemnation? How did I get that guilt, Lord? And in that darkest hour, God said to me, "Son, dream again. I've already perfected you. Just keep trusting me." And can I tell you that when you trust and believe right, he'll restore everything that the devil has stolen from you. In fact, not only will he restore, but he'll give you better than what you lost. He'll make it even better. Can I speak to those of you that said, "Preacher, I don't want religion. I just want this Jesus to take this weight off me." If I'm talking to you, I want you to be bold enough. I don't care if your wife goes to church and you don't. It's not about that now. It's about whether or not you want to accept Jesus as the only one that can satisfy and pay the debt for you. If I'm talking to you and you say, "Preacher, this is my day. I'm not going to wait till tomorrow. I ain't going to wait till another Easter. Today I'm going to surrender it to Jesus." If I'm talking to you, I want you to make a bold step today, sir. Make a bold step today, ma'am. Make a bold step to me, young people. Listen to me and say, "Yes, I believe that Jesus paid it all for me." At the count of three, I want you to lift your hands high and may this day be the best day of your life. May this day be the first of the best days of your life. At the count of three, say, "I'm going to lift my hands before God." And I don't care if you've done this 100 times before. I promise you it won't be the same after you do it today. One, two, three, lift your hands. That's it. I see your hands all over the temple. That's it, all over. Today is my day. I'm going to believe Jesus. I'm going to trust Jesus. I ain't even going to trust in myself. I'm going to trust him and what he's done. Now, if your hand was up, and I saw many hands up, and you say, and there's some of you who didn't put your hand up because you say, well, I'm already saved, but maybe you don't have a church home. Maybe you never received Jesus as your Lord. Maybe you never joined the ministry that is thriving, that teaches you how to live this walk. Well, this is the church for you. I know I can help you. I know what we have to give you here can help you live the abundant life and experience the glory of God. I want to help you. I don't want to see you go through life. I want to pastor you. I want to take that time to share. We have pastors here on staff that will nurture you and help you dream again and to trust God again. And if that's you today, you said, preacher, I'm born again, I'm saved, but I don't have a church. If I'm talking to you, will you lift your hand? Today, I want to be a part of this great church. Lift your hands if I'm talking to you. Thank you, Jesus. All right, if your hand was up, if your hand was up, can you do one more favor for me and for the Lord? Can you make one more step of faith? Can you come here and join me here at the altar? Your hand was up, or if your hand was up, but you know you got to come today, will you come right now? Come on, if you had your hand up, just make that step of faith. Come on, I see you coming. I see you coming. Come on, clap your hands for them. Come on, some of them got to come along. If your hand was up, just make your way up to this altar. I want to, come on, that's it. If your hand, come on, saints. It's time to come back home. It's time to come back to your God. Come on, put your hands together, everybody, as they are coming. Come on, as they are coming. Clap your hands, everybody. Clap your hands. Come on. Come on, sir. Come on. Will you clap a little louder? Because heaven is rejoicing right now. I see you back there. Come on, we got room for you. Come on, will you clap, saints? They're still coming. I see you back there. Come on, come on. Come on, keep on clapping. There's some others who just need a little encouragement. That's all. They just need a little encouragement. Come on, come on. Clap your hands. Come on, come on. Glory to God. Glory to God. We believe Jesus. He's paid it all. No more religion. No more weights. I'm just going to live for him. Come on, saints. Clap one more time because somebody's in a struggle. But if you made that step, my friend, your life will never, ever be the same. Somebody give the Lord a shout. Woo! Will you give the Lord a praise for these lives that are changing right before our eyes? God bless you. Amen. Amen. All of you that are standing before me, my heart is overwhelmed. I'm so thrilled. Oh, I can't hardly contain myself. Will you lift your hands before God, wherever you are, and just repeat this prayer real quickly before me? Amen. And just say this with Heavenly Father, I believe Jesus is Lord. So I come to you just as I am. You know everything about me. You know every place I've been. You know everything I've done. So I come to you today just as I am. I receive Jesus. I receive his gift. And today I confess him as my Lord.